Greetings and salutations. This is Rick Koppel coming at you from Rick Koppel channel. So, yeah, we're gonna do a flight today or tonight, actually. In my own time zone, it's a flight to the to tonight. In Australian time zone, it's a flight tomorrow during the day. It's already daylight over there. Been there since about 2 o'clock p.m. our time. Mountain time, at least. So we'll get on over there and get started on it and start on our flight and our last leg of this flight from Brisbane to Sydney. Yeah. So we'll scooch you on over there, why don't we? Okay. Should be seeing a screen that shows all the different airplanes I can select. I could use Beechcraft King Air, although I'm not real familiar with that one yet. I could use the jet if I wanted to, but then it'd be faster. So I got my little Cirrus SR-22 custom by the color I liking. So we're gonna start off in Brisbane over international here. See all the IDs. That's how I find out what the IDs are. I get the name of the airport, then I put type it in, and do a search on it. You can also see states. You can also see these things. I'm not sure what they are. Somebody FAA, city, state, custom scenery. That's different. Favorites different. So that's all in Queensland. All these are in Queensland. Brisbane probably is one of the few cities named Brisbane in the world, so it's not hard to figure that out, huh? Yeah. So anyway, we're gonna start on Brisbane International on runway 01 left. 01 left. It's clear today according to real weather downloaded there. And it's tracking real world time is at 12:02 local time. So it's about lunchtime there. All right, let's start the flight. Hopefully this doesn't crash on me. Here we are finally. I think I figured out what I had to do is to stop recording the OBS and to start this going first. Then I can start it up and that kind of thing. Let's start our engines here. Like I said before, I'm not really a pilot. I don't know anything about much of anything. Matter of fact, this parts I haven't figured out yet, basically. But that's my GPS display over here. Here I've got my heading monitor. And your GPS function if you have nav on. And you have your horizon here indicator. You have your airspeed over here and your altitude altimeter over here, which tells you your altitude. Barometric pressure down there. And yeah, so you get all the information. We're on this runway right here. Somewhere. I think that's us right there. A little looks like a crosshair, but it's actually like my wings sticking way out. So they stick way out from the runway. Anyway, take off, and when we take off, then we need to do our flight plan. Yeah. So we will. Now you have key bindings on here for all everything. So do this, and we'll go down here. We'll flash this up. Bring to zoom this in. Your flight plan right there. That's where we're at currently, YBBN. That's Brisbane's code. And YSSY is Sydney Kingsford Smith Airport. It's right over here. Now, That's Australia. He knows here. 406 miles. Estimated elevation is 151. So that should be about 2 to 3 hours, I think. It's supposed to be a 2 to 3 hour video. More exact, more better estimate when I plug it in, make it active. But yeah, so press enter twice to accept it. Now this is kind of big. You notice up here it says our destination is where we're at. You want that, so what you have to do is you have to go down here to the menu. Use this little dial right here to go invert flight plan. Press enter. Now you see there's a line heading out of Brisbane like that, and it goes all the way to Sydney. That's your heading. And your heading is going to be 181 degrees. So it's just a hair south, basically. Hair due west toward from the south of the pole. 1 degree, actually, 180. So we'll take that and we'll fly on. So what you have to do now is you have to set your heading. So 181 is your heading. Notice here, the destination has changed up here. 407 nautical miles. And your heading is 183. So now we gotta change your heading and then do that. We gotta go on the other screen. There's the fuel here, it always starts off with a little fuel, so you have to add fuel, which we'll do in a minute before we take off. So we got that, let me bring up this one. Now, the heading buttons and stuff are all down, the altitudes are right here. That's our heading indicator, 183. This little blue dot, you'll see move around when I start doing this. And you see over here in the left part up here is heading. It's currently set at 38 degrees is what we used last time we used this thing. Anyway, so in 16 degrees is where we're pointed at. Our nose is pointed at right now. So, 83. Go over this way a little bit. When anyone is what it was, right? Yep. Yeah. When anyone. It says 81 up there, but I know that's wrong. We'll be going that way. Some of that effect. So that's heading now. Click this heading button down here, and it also activates your flight director, which is these purple the things added in there. Flight director, basically, heading in the altitude that uses flight director. Now, you can't manually fly a flight director, but when you hit autopilot over here right above there, it'll automatically follow the flight director wherever the flight director goes. How autopilot works with most of these machines. So now we just have to decide, well, I think we can get away with the 5,000 feet flight, so we're going to move this up to 5,000 feet. Oh, great. And there, 5,000 feet. Now you can click the altimeter and I'll set that. And you can click VS, which is your vertical speed indicator. You can do that later on when you get in there and you just want to turn on your automatic pilot. You can do it now. 2, 3. So you go down to go up. This little blue thing right there. Watch this going up as I go up. That tells you vertical speed right there. So we're going to go 700 feet per minute, I think is what that's recorded in as. And yeah, so it's a good amount. And you see our flight director now is up here, which is about it's a good setting for that, I guess you could say. But anyway, so we got that set, now we're ready to fly, I think, after we fuel up. Now, how you fuel up in this is not how you fuel up in a regular thing. Matter of fact, the gas is free. You don't have to pay for it, thankfully. So fly. You edit weight balances, right? And this is what I was talking about, weight balances. And I see a pilot they had in there listed as 500 pounds for pilots. If you had 2 or 3 pilots. But since I'm by myself and I'm only one pilot and I weigh 189 pounds, that's what I put in, 189 pounds. Gave me a lot more room to see up here for total weight in pounds. But I can get up to here. So what you do is, since you see you have this center of gravity, which means it's kind of leaning to the right side of the plane. So what I do is I put it all maximum amount of the fuel in for the left. Then I close the rest of it off with right. I get up to close to the maximum weight. There you go. Now this isn't how a real pilot would do it, but that's how I do it in here. Just gotta have enough fuel to fly all the way. Which this will be, that'll be plenty of fuel to fly 400 miles in this thing. So once I do that, I apply changes. Alright, then we're ready to roll. Okay. Now you can get ready to go. So what you have to do now is you gotta release your brake, apply power, and take off. Now you notice it's kind of red through here, and this red line here, that's your stall area. So once you get up enough speed where that red goes away, and you'll see it go down at this point, and that indicates enough lift on your wings to lift off, and you rotate at that point with the call rotate, so you can take off. So that's what we're going to do now. Ready to take off, let's get this chip underway. There's a problem on the senior package, resource depot, senior manager, please. Okay, understood. It's not a critical error at least. Okay, so release brake, and there we go. Let's put a little left rudder. There's whatever to fill it in there. See there, above where the red is coming down? Okay, it says we can rotate to lift off. One, two, you can follow the flight director. Pause this for a moment. What we gotta do is we gotta set this on the right pilot. And it should be Let's see. And then here, out of my palette's right there. Can't see it very well, but it's right there. So what we'll do is we'll hit P and we'll make it hit on the palette. And see how that's automatically going to the right. And we'll let it see what we look like from outside. We are flying over the runway. Setting our course for Sydney, Australia. Brisbane. We'll be on the road again. And then we're going to start singing. So there you go. Going in the other direction. And here we are. Flying away from the port in Brisbane. It's a good thing about all my pods, you can do all this fun stuff on the outside while you do it. So you can see what I look like in there. Yeah, it's a nice little beard there. Which I don't have in real life right now. We've got doing food stuff, so I shaved off my beard. Maybe one time I look like that. I don't have those kind of glasses either. So I'm sorry to do it anyway. Yeah. So let's see what's going on here so we can see we're almost up to 3,000. See, it's automatically going vertical speed. And we're going that way. Now, if we had nav on, maybe this would eventually line up with this and line up with that. And if you're hand flying, you could line it up yourself personally. You see, it's flying out. I gotta make sure the rudder's set. There you go. Center the rudder red, or set it so. Error problems, that kind of thing. And there you go. We're flying. I can see its vertical speed is 650 feet per minute, and it's slowly going up to 5,000. When it gets 5,000, it'll automatically stop. Thanks to the wonders of automatic pilot. You see, all my pilots keeping those yellow bars right under the pink bars. Apparently, we're on our heading. Beyond. It says 183 here, but 181 do we have? Which we can look at the other screen, see how they're tracking on that. It's probably a little off because it's never exactly going to do any headings and stuff until you try to have. That's a problem with the navigation on the 74 though. Let's see, we're over here on the side of it. We're flying the same direction as the line is for the most part. So, cool. And you have those little beacons out here that guide the big jets into the system. Pull some on one beacon, some on different beacons, things like that. You know, what way they're going to land at and that kind of thing. Now, yeah, let's clear this out. And see more of the GPS, clear that out. So, there's plenty of stuff to keep you busy in this plane for the most part as you're going along. Between switching tanks every once in a while, you gotta keep track of that. If you're actually doing the comm, now I'm not doing any comm work on this because I don't understand the comm that well to do it. So they want me to do things I don't know how to do and stuff like that. Taxi to Charlie, Victor, and then, you know, take this taxiway there and then the whole short runway, blah, 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 and take off. You're cleared for takeoff, and once I've landed, you know, I'm ready to take off. But they say, tell them that. So, and you never get cleared for takeoff, you never ask for it. So, yeah. So, anyway, what was I going to do? I was going to, oh, yeah. That'll be there. It says about 1,000 feet, just past 4,000 feet climb. So now it's gonna gradually level off at 5,000 feet as it does that. So you learn a few things doing this stuff, huh? So, but I'm not a pilot, so don't take anything I say as gospel or the way you should be doing things. I'm sure some of the things I do in here are not the way that most pilots do things. I only know how to put in that much of flight plan. That's pretty much it. Maybe more clear. Flight plan's still there, but it's cleared out of the way. See, you got a lot bigger spot here. Now you can get a bigger view of things by bringing this up on the range button. The only thing I'd like to do, at least early in this, is just 5,000 feet gonna be enough. When we get up to 5,000 feet, get our gas over here. Gallon, it's almost full based on what I told it. This says we're using the climb rate, we're using 23.9 gallons per hour, I think. Yeah, gallons per hour. Gallons per hour. So use that to calculate if you have enough gas, see where you want to go. Up here is the time. So looking now, we got 2 hours and 45 seconds. 2 minutes, 45, no, let's go another way, 2 minutes, 45, 46 seconds out. I don't know what the down time is, what's going down. ETE is estimated time of something, entry into the space or something like that. So we got 2 hours to reply on this, and yeah, 392 miles per hour. Nautical miles, but those are straight miles. Thank you, it's another ET. Yeah, it's going up 2 seconds. Oh, it's going down. Yeah, it is. ET 2. That's going down and up. I don't know why, but one's going down, one's going up. Hours, 22 minutes. Well, I think maybe this changed, so now it's 2 hours, 22 minutes for a reach of destination. So yeah, that's probably what it is. Maybe we can make this bigger. Sydney, we're flying over some terrain here. We notice this is at 5,000, which it is. We level off 5,000. We need to bring a power back, cruise speed. Not like that. So flow rate's going down to 18.4, it looks like there. 19.4. Yeah, 18.4 gallons per hour. Yeah, you don't want to run your engine at max for too long, because if you do, then it can burn your engine up or something eventually. Reduce the life of your engine, that kind of thing. So most commercial pilots don't even take off with full power. Most of the time, they just have it under a certain level they know that they need to get off the ground. The amount of space they have, they do all the calculations for that, they plug in the flight plan and all that kind of stuff. Very detailed. We're just getting going on this thing. So what I like to do though, go down here to map, click on the soft programmable button, and then hit terrain. So there's yellows, means there's a bit areas that will pass over, that will be very, very close to the ground. But if you see any red spots, that's what you need to worry about. Which I don't see any red spots there at all, so we're good. At 5,000 feet. I wanted to make double sure I just looked up a little bubble, see what it looks like. We come to that part of the mountainous area there. We'll see how it goes. It'll be exciting when we get that one wanted. But yeah, that's about 200 nautical miles out though, most of the way. So, yeah. Now you see what the pilot see has time. Meanwhile, in Dolphin City. Oh yeah, I've seen this. I leave terrain on since we're going to go over some higher areas. But I'm going to zoom back down a little bit. There's a runway over there. You see all these runways? There's a runway over here. Runway up there. Right, this is a runway. It's a small runway. It's like a grass field or a dirt field or something like that. And a few of those. And my time around Australia, running around Australia. There's another airport there. Another grass field there. A commercial jet can never land on any of those, but depending on the, I'm not sure how they figure these out, but I think this is a bigger field than this. The blue color is bigger than the bright red or something. Red may be decent sized runway, but it's not as big as the other color. I'm not sure about that though. Real pilot might have information on that. So, just check outside and see what we're seeing. Or, oops. There we are, there's our wings. Make sure, I don't think we put on any flaps when we took off this time, so this plane's fast enough, you really don't have to have it, but it helps to get it up off the ground if you do. Let's see. Well, if the amount of runway had there, no problem getting off the ground. Okay, so P. That I don't have to do. And you see the ocean out there. Vast, uncharted ocean. You fire the plane. So what's on the other side, you ask? Then you see more mountains out that direction. Gradually come in where we come in. We're going to head to the edge up in there, as you saw on our terrain map. Exciting to see it. This is why I tell you, this one time I was coming toward a mountain. Even though the terrain said I wasn't going to hit it, it looked all the world like I was going to run flat into it. I couldn't help but grab the yoke and pull back. I don't want to. But yeah, generally they're accurate though. And if you trust your instruments, you can trust them better. You can trust yourself. You see the mountains out there more too. Mountains, Gandalf, mountains. So you have all that. Yeah, so now this is the part where pilots usually just sit and chat. There's a minimal work to do. There's usually checklists and stuff. I mean, I don't bother with that because it is important if you're really learning to fly, but I'm not, so therefore I don't have to worry about checklists that much. But everything's pretty much set on these things. You usually check your gauges and your make sure your ailerons are working and all that kind of stuff. Make sure your elevator is working. And, you know, maybe you stick around, that kind of thing. Which it's important to do if you're in the real world. You don't want to take any chances if it's a real life death situation that you're flying over. But for a virtual plane, of course, it happens as I go in and crash. Big fiery mess, and then everything gets reset, and I go again. So, you know, not much of a reason to worry too much about all that stuff unless you're learning how to fly an airplane, actually learning how to fly an airplane. So, just take shortcuts, and I don't worry about comms. And I mean, if you talk to them, they'll talk to you and expect you to follow orders, and they'll ask you, why aren't you doing this? Hey, do you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? All that kind of stuff over and over again. Then one time I didn't want to put a transponder signal. One time I didn't know how to do it. I do know now. Figured out finally, but I only put a transponder signal and I didn't have a clue how to do that. So I didn't do it. And he kept saying, wanted me to read back my instructions to him and all that kind of stuff. Why have you done it? Why haven't you done it yet? I need a new signal. All that kind of stuff. Transponder sends a certain cutoff which identifies you to the ground control in the tower, basically. It tells you what plane is, what your signal is, and how high up the altitude, gives them altitude information, all that kind of stuff on the radar. But, we're going up that way, you definitely have some red. You have to go up higher, like about 6, 7, maybe even 8,000 feet, maybe. I'd actually really get over that turn. And here we go. I think I should have turned on my landing lights when I was taking off. Sounds strange, you have to turn on landing lights when you're taking off. It's good practice to get into. But you definitely want to turn on when you're landing, especially at night. But even when you're not night, you're supposed to have one, I think, when you're landing. It's one of the things a checklist would help you do, take care of. You can see the mountains off in the distance now, can't you? Yeah, they creep closer and closer and closer toward you. Oh no. So we're flying right to the east of the line, but it's pretty much flying pretty level with the line. I don't know if it's going to intersect at some point, cross over, whatever. Probably ought to, though, because what would have happened is we're about to get to our first part of the mountains over here. Foothills. And we get closer and closer to it. And sighting or sight. See, it looks like we're running into the mountains of it. Yet there's no terrain saying, no red terrain saying you're going to run about. You're going to do something wrong. Song, so to speak. There's an airport over there. Then we are going to shoot over the mountains, we pray. Maybe we go ahead and switch our guessing, because we're going to keep the right lower and the left, since the right's got more weight on it. Right? I think so. And it's always defaults to the left tank being used. See, it's almost 140 gallons from the thing we set it on. So we're going to go down. Our 20 minutes is what it says we have in this video. Bring it to, there's our fuel tanks. I don't really understand why you have to do this, but you have to turn on the fuel pump in order to switch tanks. So I turn that on, now switch tanks, now turn it off. See, I don't know why, but my fuel tank has to do that, but it does, apparently. Okay. Now we can look outside. See, now it's creeping up. Here, over in the mountains, I don't know what I'm gonna do. Climb, climb up some shiny mountain. So yeah, we're floating along here. And if you see any red suddenly pop up for some reason, maybe you didn't spot before. Something bad, but I want to put on pause or something so I can do that. And that's across this one ridge over here. There's the ridge I was talking about, those mountains. See, we're well above it. Go outside to see what I'm talking about. See the mountains. You can see the mountains where it says. And we're doing a feeling of style. This one is interesting. I'll show you right there. The stationary that flies up past you. They said I'm really going fast, aren't we? We have no time at all that way. Do it again. This way. We were sat down there with her. The road, you can see down there. And the ridge coming up here. Green's only gonna see bright yellow yet. We're supposed to remember a little patch of it. Some point here. But here it looks synonymous the way it's going. Down there's a road. cars. Yeah, that's one thing about this thing. It seems like the traffic is heavy on some of these roads all the time back. Maybe it really is real life for all I know, but yeah, I've yet to get to the high stuff even. Power stuff. Or the yellow is. This one looks like I'm hitting it or something. Talk about stuff about related flight to explain what an evaluation of it is. You can see it's pretty realistic. I mean, there's things about it that aren't realistic, like you can run through houses or your plane not have an accident. You can run through trees with your plane not have an accident. You can run through other vehicles with your plane not have an accident. You can run through other airplane not have an accident. Of course, in real life that would never happen. You'd be dead in water. Around or something like that. So things about it that aren't very realistic in that regard, but I think Microsoft Flight Simulator says playing back in the 80s, it would wreck if you hit the tree or a house or something like that. But yeah, for some reason this doesn't seem to. Doesn't seem to have that feature, and I don't know if it's a setting you set where you make it wreck or have some problems. Because if you hit the ground, it definitely has a wreck. If you hit a rock, it's sticking up out of the ground by trees or something, reaches out, and then you'll have a wreck. So there are certain things it will have wrecks with. The ground, rocks, and other features like that. But you can, it's also very realistic in the way that the controls are laid out. I mean, you can see all the various things in a realistic way that the controls are laid out in here. And you have to turn the knobs and push the buttons and stuff to enter in things like that. And it's like real. And some of the other ones I can't even enter them in because I don't know how to do it exactly. This one at least has a keyboard that you can punch your letters in. So having to twist a dial and hit it in and push it in and get it type thing. And I'm wondering, I think there's more rounds coming up. Yeah, there's some coming up, I think. So if we have 2 hours or 12 minutes flight time left. If you heard that noise, you might hear some other noises because these hotel walls are very thin, it seems like. So it's not rats running around in the wall or anything, I hope not at least. But it's just what it is. I sit here in the hotel room playing my simulator, watching the scenery go by. It's a fun part. I'm somebody that always likes to stare out windows when I'm riding on airplanes. I don't know why, I just like to see it passing around and see how the little thing looks, or how big it looks, especially from a jet. You're not way up in the sky like that. You're 36,000 feet up in the air and you look down at the world behind you. It's interesting to see the world from that perspective, for me at least. So, I kind of like just sitting here and watching the scenery pass by. Seeing them down, wondering about all the people down there. Then you see me up there. Now, one time I passed over an airport, and one of the thing features has on it, you can do a tower view. And so I did a tower view, but I was so far up, I think I was 9,000, 6,000 feet up at that point. 5,000 feet, probably the same thing. But I couldn't see nothing. All I could see is just it was tracking me. The tower was tracking me as it went by, but I couldn't see the plane because it was too small. So that was interesting. But sometimes you see some things around here. You see all these lakes, or all the lakes probably. Just bald patches where the trees have been thrown back, whatever. Yeah, well, you may wonder what all the other lines are on or something like we have. Each airport has its own radius of airspace, I guess you could say. But Brisbane covers a whole sector all the way back over to Gibbs, I think. And Brisbane is a call center, if you want to call. We go up here, we go up here. Click this button, you see the air traffic control window. So it's talking to all these various air traffic control, the blue ones, I believe. He's telling them to put his transponder code is 1008, radar contact. Heading 0 is right, see saw Brisbane. Brisbane Air Control Center. And those are two options I have, but if I want to just contact, I would say request flight following or observe a position, and it'll tell you where you're at. So those are like the rings and the, on the around the airport that extend out, and it tells you basically where, what airspace you're in. Say, Brisbane has a much bigger space that they cover than just that part. And, but that's their area where when you're in there, you better identify yourself and tell who you are and what you're doing there, where you're headed, that kind of thing. That's all information, you know, basically. Usually they just say, to Brisbane, either ID, transfer, which means you want to transfer from another ground control, tower control. So you'll, tower control will say, okay. And then you'll tell them where you're going, that kind of thing. What altitude you're flying at, they can verify it. And the controller appears past the transponder code. Now, the transponder code I got here is one for what's called VFR, which is visual flight reference, I think. VFR, that VOR, which is a instrument, type of instrument, type control, and the IFR, which is instrument flight control or something like that. So IFR means you can't really see anything visually. You can look out your window, but it's not going to do you any good because it's all white. You're in clouds and stuff, these are rainstorms, fog, things like that, and where you can't see where you're going. So they have this IFR tracking system, which I don't know how to use, so I can't use it. But it sinks down into a certain area. Gives you that control, and They usually build. That's how planes can, jets can fly in on. Sink down in these level clouds. If you see clouds, it goes down into them and sink, and it comes right out over the runway. So, yeah, it's all done by instruments, a lot of it. Usually at some point they have to get visual contact the runway in order to land. So the runway's a fallback, so then they just shut down the airport and stuff like that. No, can't come here. We're fogged in. Or once you get to a certain level, I forget what the level is, once you get to a certain level of fog or visual distance, then you can't land in an airport. Some airlines that I understand also have their own rules about in that regard, what pilots can and can't do. Yeah, they were about to get close to there where we had the mountains that were higher up. And they gave us yellow on the terrain warning system. Yeah, you can see him. Look at the left one here real quick. Now the rocket tank is leaving gallons. It's almost 730 gallons. It's halfway between 30 and 40 there. It's 18.3 gallons. So based on 18.3 gallons per hour, and you got 2 hours left to go, that means you're going to need 16 gallons. Or excuse me, no, 32 gallons. So we got 32 gallons, and you have 40 in your left tank and 30 in your right tank. So you have more, way more than that. Get where we're going. After we're about to run up, you'll just have to keep the balance. So once this gets down to say about 30 or 20 gallons, then I'll switch back left tank and start using that up. So it won't get out of balance too much. Oil pressure's in the green, and temperature's in the green. And our EBS buses are working fine. Battery A. And everything in the green there. No problems. And we're powered up. 55% power. Can you emphasize how fast our props moving? 2,420 feet per minute. And there's our 12.6 is an HG, which I assume is barometric pressure. Or maybe that's something else related to this, I'm not sure exactly. Oh, see, there's an airport right there. BYBYL. And we'll transfer over. In fact, I need to adjust this heading so it's moved over to see. Range, and so I can see how far away we exactly are. I know we're like 2 hours from the game on this, but I want to see visually how far away we are. What mountains we're going to have to go over. It still shows them as not red. This is what I'm most concerned about. I don't know why it changed. I don't know if I've changed it, but it's in real life. But just a comfort thing. I feel better seeing it, knowing it still says the same thing it said before. I missed anything. Maybe yes, there was a bit of red there, and I'm going to run into it. I didn't see it because it's so small on the radar thing here. Okay, let's pull this up. And let's expand this out a bit so we can see them coming into it. But yeah, let's see how the airport's There's many airports around the city. You have time to fly around. There are a lot of airports. Yeah, there's the peaks. Shouldn't be right over. I don't see any red in there at all. There's red that we had to go higher, that's for sure. It shows how far away we're not even halfway yet. That would be about halfway across from there. And we should be fine on that front. Alright. Yeah, this is boring because it's not really all exciting to watch a plane fly through the air. I mean, this is probably too boring too, so. Yeah. Especially if you don't have anything to look out the window. If you're just seeing the ocean, that's it. As you are running across some of those bays at times. It seems like you're running across some of those bays and it, it's just blue water down there, that's it. No variation. That's when it starts to get boring for me. This is interesting for the most part, for me, at least. So. Back down so we see that. We're flying over now. Let's do this. Shift 5. So this is a tower at the airport that we're flying over. Can't even really see where I'm at. There. It's tracking me obviously as it goes across the sky. This building might have been in the way though, so we'll see. I can't see anything. If anybody else can, my eyes are really good sometimes. That's what I'm saying. I'm 5,000 miles up, so 5,000 miles, 5,000 feet up. Excuse me. Faux pas of the year. So I've been out of space, so it's 5,000 miles up. So. Yes, yeah, so that's what it's like. You can see. What I like to do sometimes is put a little thing on pause. I look for airports especially. I'm expecting airport to be somewhere over there. I put it on pause and I'll scoot around there and look all over and look at the airport. About kind of where there it is. It's going to be higher than the plane is now. across the ladder, it's beside another hillside, so there's really no place for it. Here we are, flying over flat plains. I'm gonna adjust our heading a little bit. Yeah. I'm going to come in on this side of the line. The idea is that when we get to Sydney, I'll be able to be here for an hour. These ones, all these fancy things on, all this weird stuff. I've noticed that some of these are military airports. This is one of them, but it looks fancy, but it's red. This means something to them, I'm sure. So if somebody who knows something about this, they probably put in the comments what all these lines mean. Different types and different styles, colors. And they all have purpose, like the difference between blue runway here and the pink or purple or reddish runways here. But the cool thing is they give you the direction runways are at in there, one of the main runways. Of course, the main ones you'll see two of them or something like that. Let's go see when we get over to Sydney. We'll see how all those mesh up. So this is one of the more realistic parts of the, is how the controls work and the procedures you use to get see what it feels down to 30 gallons on the right tank now. So yeah, so you can get that. Also, if we get enough of an angle, we want to cut on this side of Sydney, so we'll have some room to maneuver into a good glide path in there. I'm going to adjust the heading just a tad to my right. I have to think backwards because you're going downwards, so any movement to the right. And there is a net or a thing, the bus or runways. I get confused crazy myself on these things. it took me forever to figure out VR. You already had this little line, and you're supposed to say something. If you want to go towards something, you have to go away from it. Yeah, so pretty great. Makes sense when you really think about it and figure it out, but for a while it's like, what? What is that? Yeah, so. We have to go down here and get our heading changed a bit. Okay, so now let's see. Left, whatever left is that, so we need to go this way, 9 degrees or two, there's me off 9 degrees or two, let's see, to our left is right. Very red and green. Yep, we're red across the line. So So we in Sydney, we'll be on the other side of the line. You'll see. One thing I was questioning about, I always had a question about, is the black box be floating around throughout the plane? And it usually has some numbers if you look at it close up. Usually has some numbers in like plus 53, plus 72, something like that. I'm not sure what that is, what it means, but anyway, I'm sure it means something. Some kind of information that you need to know. I don't know about it, never knew what it meant, but sometimes it has a weather map. Gotta pull that up here a minute. Should be heading close to heading in the hills where it gets its peak here in a minute. So shut it down with our coming doom. Fog in there a little bit, not much, but a tad, just a touch, and then a little hazy. It's going to be a license. Should we think of it as a license? Maybe we ain't in it, it's the high stuff yet. But nice to eat. You need to be seeing about it coming up. See where the road over is now, so yeah, that's why we're running to it in the area where I can go. The biggest thing about landing is controlling your airspeed. I'm bad about coming in too high and so when I'm too fast and shoot that way. Somewhat land long, as they say. Sometimes you're long if you're doing the wrong thing, but it's an exceptional situation where it's likely that doing the wrong way, but you're having obstacles like someone like here with the runways here at Sydney's airport, you'll be in the water coming off in the red and see. And planes don't fly very good in the water very well. Yep, sure. They fly through air in the water. Seems like I hear some air. So, There's a big area right over here. Right, there'd be yellow. Let's get this peak over here. There's a big old yellow spot over there. Over here. I gotta go over it, but we're gonna make some of that for us too. So, you know, these mountains are less than 5,000 feet, at least. Yeah, as far as I can see, mountains. Some range in Australia. Doesn't like the Rockies here in the United States, obviously. Or I think they have some thousands, close to thousands of Pike Peaks. I think Pike's Peak is about 14,000, 13,000 feet up there, something like that. So for it's getting hard to see greens. That high up. Dead oxygen, if you're a pilot like me, that's probably over 2,000 feet up there. I've been on about over 12,000 feet on the highway. Peak of it was 12,000 some odd feet. Not that high for long. That's pretty good fixation. Went there long enough until you got used to it at least. I mean, Denver's known as about high city. Alma, the highest corporate city in America, being known as a 2 mile high city, it's about 10,485 feet or something like that, 87 feet, something like that. Okay, here we're coming to. It looks like. That seems to be talking about that. It's just one way over there. It's supposed to go up there, but it's a ways off still. This isn't so far, we're coming up to it pretty fast. Yeah, we're past it, but like it says, barely. Peaks or let's just crash and burn if we hit it. They don't have a bunch of them, they don't have that any investigation and all stuff like that. Now you see these big turbines are supposed to go close to the back. God knows they're shooting up at the top and shooting down. Yeah, a lot of turbulence right now. I like the games. Maybe we're also going to talk about the British down the bottom. This is Yes, I'm not going to do that. front of the back of the field, and start playing. That would be too lovely to step to the ground. You can see the airplanes that I can actually have a tarsus in white and yellow. Drops me way down, way down, way down, way down, way, way, way down. If you ever yell at him. Yeah, we're coming out of yellow. We got some more peaks here in the north floor. Yeah. Wait for the thing that says we need to send there. Cross all this over here. Here. And cross all this over here. We can't start really sitting until we get over here somewhere. There's another thing I'd like to do on this. Sea level to me over here. We're going to go through this heading change now too. Let's use these to right. Too far away, I was across the river. I can readjust the slope of the heading on that. So that's find out in case this is view. As it gets closer, I'll branch much closer until I have it set. We land on any runway in Sydney. See if I have enough miles. I see this radius as I have enough miles. So, not bad. All right, about here we can start the city. Then I will just make sure we don't miss out there most successfully. We'll sit past to Sydney, Houston, National Airport. That'll be fun. putting this file on a 2 terabyte hard drive, so I better have it. They're not using up the file space too bad. I don't know what Easter eggs are in this thing, but it'd be funny if we arrived and had a big party being thrown for us at the airport. That flew around, waiting for somebody to send fly around Australia. And that was the first one they intended to do it or whatever. So, who knows? It just kind of happened by accident, basically. I said one day, I think I fly to Melbourne, Sydney. Go down there, and, yeah, I can make it to Perth. Go there, should I go all the way around or not? So I did. It was kind of gradually, just a day by day basis. So I just kept flying and kept going. Half hour step, I'll just keep running. Kept flying. Yeah, I think I said I estimate I put in about 16 to 18 hours flight time flying around of this area. This is real flight time, obviously. It's 2 hour long. Over 2 hour 40 minutes, I think. Where the beginning was, 2 hour 20 minutes. Video. So, flight simulator, this flight simulator X-Plane is pretty, it's X-Plane 12 by the way, pretty good, but I don't have it the other way. I'm not going to be paying like I, well, I figured out on why I kept having problems. I was trying to start X-Plane while I had OBS running. That was what was conflicting with. As soon as I turned OBS off as far as recording with, started X-Plane, started up, and I was able to get in. And I turned OBS back on, and it works fine. But I had a problem with the other thing happening, and next thing you know, I had a problem every time I tried to start it up. And it becomes OBS and apparently that's what they do. Keep in mind about that X-Plane and the other thing. After I try to browse while I X-Plane to them, the browser always crashes. Yeah, strange, isn't it? Like it sucks in your way, like a lot of business. It's high graphics thing, and this computer has an NVIDIA graphics driver in it, so that takes care of the graphic part of it pretty much. Transfer back outside, so this is interesting, but not highly entertaining. This entertaining is there. Check fuel, we're down 20 miles. This seems like you lean left right in it. And it is. We're supposed to take back. We have a plan this to about 4 o'clock in the morning before the 12 o'clock start. Then the dawn hits me. So about the time it picks up the plane. I think it's on the other screen though. Let's see. Yeah, it looks like we're in the room. Stretched out there, that's a hitter. So I can do that way in the city. I debated whether to show the whole flight or just parts of it and stuff like that. But a lot of people can jump around if they want to. The objective is the only thing in chapters. Just to be parsing them in the hills, parts, whatever. Landing, and all that stuff. So, people can be where a person wants. Watch. I had to show all things if you want to watch all the things, or if you're silent, you're just not a check. Or wreck and flame ball of fire. It's a hope I have. Yeah. I'm over to the north, that way there, or in this direction, or yellow, of that, but I mean to send us yellow over here, but I'm running in that direction, matter of fact, I can start to sit down very gradually. Best to get over these hills before I start sitting. You know, I probably have the room to start now. This is risking it. At Sydney Pass, I see the boom. Bada bing, bada boom type thing going on there. I noticed all the airports right here start with Y. They also do Papua New Guinea, so it must be a regional thing. Whereas in America, most of the airports start with K. I'm sure there's some madness to reasons this madness, but they have their part. Letters stand for different parts of the world, apparently. The first letter on these airport names, and the rest, three letters, mean depending on this, like YSSY is Sydney, Sydney, I'm sure I'm Sydney, but it's YSS from Sydney, obviously. That's where the middle, the third and first is coming from. And Brisbane is what, YBBD, I think. I've been on there somewhere. YBBN, Brisbane, BNBN, Brisbane. Some, well, that was pretty out there. It was layered. This is there. Layered hills. That looks like we're coming down to the, this one makes me wonder if we really are going to come down. So it looks like the hills go forever out here. I mean, about Sydney down now. I'm going to sit down now with all those hills and show them. It's at the bottom of our screen there. Sydney's making its entrance. Screen. Right in this hill is a mountain. Well, at some point, though, believe me, you will, at some point, go down across Sydney. She's sitting at sea level in most part, so it's gotta go down at some point. In fact, the flight from Denver to Austin or San Antonio is only about 2 hours long. And I'll be looking at that window seat. I'll be looking at the window the whole time pretty much. Until nightfall when I can't see anything. Like, I'll be looking at the lights of cities and stuff like that. I'll stare out the window for hours. I've always been that way on trips. I did the same thing in the car. So, like, I remember one time when I was going down to Corpus Christi. We were going around San Antonio, and I remember watching it. It was all about the lights and everything in the city. As we were going around the loop on San Antonio. We went on through. At the end of all the place, Texas, where Grandma was staying, used to live. And voila, there we were. There's Sydney coming up on us. We're coming in the lower valleys, but I don't know if I see any lower mean. It's probably not the other stuff. But this doesn't show that. I'm really confused. The terrain map doesn't show. It looks like I've seen out of a window. There are quote binoculars up going on here. So what our help eyes can see. Yes. What perspective is? Yeah, drop down the grid to sit up on a subway. Says we have less than an hour to landing. Time 56 minutes to run. Says we went off fast. Did he tell me he was about this mountain? He's about to get over there, so that will be home free. They'll see down to sea level. And we descend at that point. We got 55 minutes and 54 seconds. And seconds now, so it's 400 an hour. 55 minutes for landing. And 46 miles to go. Right there. It looks like the rich is gonna come out right. Like the plant, but we come out of nowhere over there. Four knots, airspeed, and ground speed was 159 knots. We had a bit of a tailwind on us, so that's cool. We can make a good time, I guess. It's like 150 miles per hour. Here we go. Getting ready. Well, I'm sinking too. What happened? Pause it real quick. I don't know what happened. It's somewhere. Yeah, but sure, we probably should pause the whole thing. We have to extinguish. I see. You're going so good too. See, headings on. Automatic pilot is on. Flight director's on. Altitude. Oh, so I'm attaining altitude. We're going down for some reason. I must hit someone I clicked over here. What happened? This is why pilots have to, I have a little age before I had problems, but this is the first time I ever encountered this error situation. What I could do is I could move the plane out that way. The airport over there I land at. Try and land at. Probably see 75 miles, no way. I can glide that far. Assuming my engine's going out or something on me. Fuel flow. Okay. So if I fuel flow is at a zero. Yes. in the right tank, in the left tank. So I need to maybe change it back to right tank, hope for the best. Possibly. The highway doesn't really land on that. Hopefully somebody else saw. But I wonder something. Wondering about something. I think maybe the pump has been left on or something. Maybe that gums up the worms. See, let's see. I have to restart the engine too. And if I feel from his lifetime, it's just something wouldn't have happened. Or something like that. Okay, so let's get that. And pause. Okay. Looks like we had control. All pause off everything. Going down. There's all the reds. Let's see if I can make it to 5,000 feet. Let's see where I'm at. Probably toward the coast. 120,000, 6 out of 200. So we need to go up, obviously. That's why I have so much red around me. Yeah, it's hard to see. Let me take terrain off real quick. Something. Flying basically right way since I'm flying on the heading. So, fly in the right direction at least. Yeah, the mountains as much as possible. Towards the flat coastal areas more. So, we got that, and we got. Oh. It's had some excitement to the mix, didn't it? So. So we need to just keep going where we're going, but I wanted to put the automatic power back on too. And so, let me see real quick. It's going up, so I'm leaving. 3, 6. If it goes up, it goes up. Oh, wait, we're at stall speed pressure there. 86. Not too far from stall speed, lots further than. Just because I'm not using full power to get back up. So I need to put on full power. Then I'm going to just hit the auto start flight director, heading and all that kind of stuff back on, turn back on. I may have to climb up, but I might not have to. I just stay at this level. Here on out, I think I got it. 3, 6, 20 feet. Okay, so. Heading lights off, turn that on. And flight director's on. And automatic pilot is on. It's a close call. Left the fuel pump on apparently, and then almost killed me. Fuel flow just got out to nothing. I'm not sure what the fuel pump does exactly. Anyway. So we head back up. One. Hour and 35 minutes. Our time there spent. It cost some time getting back in, but exciting though, wouldn't it? Yeah. Okay, we're almost back up to 5,000 feet, now I'm gonna start descending at some point here. Yeah, so over here. You have a few more hills to get over. And you start descending about there. Watch this, make sure it doesn't get too red. It'll be coming this way. The idea was to get over this direction, this side, and then coming this way. That's not a turn it off, turn it on like before. There's runway again. Rain, go away. To Mexico in the day. It's not driving rain, rainstorm rain. Directions knows last thing is told you to do speed, do that, so we need to turn this down. We're getting up to too high. Okay. Up to select. Select. $3,000. We're going to go down at a rate of 600 feet. There we go, now we're going down. Yay. I just need to watch the terrain map to make sure we aren't going to run any bad spots as we go down. Hold on. 6,000 feet, that's not what I said. It's confused on these things. I'm going to find the 6,000 feet. I'll tell you. Okay, that's where you have to band climb, I guess. So I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna stack 6,000 for some reason. It's just 200 feet. I can't be like that. So I gotta take this and but I'm fine. And then we stop down. And then some. And then we speed this one really slow. Oh yeah, driving rain. And that's sweet. Up the car a little bit. And the window was speeding. If you go too fast, it also has problems with that. You hear beep, beep, beep. Oops. And right away. What we see. Turn it a bit. I clear the rain, the range, the wall. Looks like we're at, Shackle. We were sitting at the house with a buzz and say hi. maybe. It's right there, but that would mean that I'd be you have to worry. It's a bad day to fly in with the hours. Stop. Flyer basically. I mean, I have to watch the ride like a hawk. As soon as it starts to shift over, I have to do something else. I can't pay attention to anything else. Well, you have some, you usually have a pilot and a co-pilot. Pilot concentrates on flying the plane, and the co-pilot basically. Watch all the other stuff. So I have about 77 miles for calls, but it comes in handy. Maybe he's having some of the thing I can look at that. 75 miles radius, 75 miles, almost 75 miles. Yeah, 40 minutes, destination 107 miles says. Going to speed 161 knots, pretty fast. So, making the autopilot kind of screwed up for him. The situation we had wasn't. Temperature probably said pause button again. Just boom, that's how I'm getting down past the hills and stuff, but it's still a good 75 miles left. More. Okay, so let's. Let's bring this up. Oops. Yeah, there it is down the edge of the thing, so that's good. Got our pipeline going down here. So the idea is to come in from the same, but I might just come in from the ocean side instead. It's safer. I have to worry about running off the end of the runway and running into Water. I'd ride straighter, that would help. Okay, so that's my plan. Break on. And then make a difference in the sky, but it'll confuse me if I land and push, try to hit the brake and then it happens. That worked more very well. Okay. Wonder if everything's off now, if we can reset things the way they should be. It worked, man, worth a try. I say go for it. And 85. 80. Local time is 14 minutes before about getting close to 5 o'clock. Past 2 o'clock. Military time. Yeah, 2 o'clock. Okay, so switch heading. Any family, so. Ready. Altitude. Working in finally, start working quickly. And we'll stay out here on this edge of the flight line. We're still on the edge there. By the time we get to Sydney, we should be able to come in from the ocean side and land on the runway. Yeah, that'll work. Thank goodness the fireworks. They have a right turn button there. Plus, we can get down closer to sea level, knowing we're going to be at sea level. The sea is level, right? So that means we can get down to 500 feet or more over the water. we find our approach. It says 42 minutes for me there. Ground speed 147, there speed's 120, 138. So we have about 10 knots of edited wind speed, tailwind speed. Fine experiment. Just so about to get familiar with this cloud breakdown too. Would be helpful. So we don't keep more angles. Sydney way up over there. Hard to see if you're here, but Sydney's right up there. Right here somewhere. The bay over there. It's up in the bays we're going to the airport. About to cross over. Should see you off the right wing here as you pass by the airport over there. Finally, you see the airport. 3,000 feet for sure, and they may be able to see us better. And they can turn around. Just to know where it is now. We've seen it in pursuit. And then it says, you're in a chunk 3, man, you know. It's distracting because I don't think you're in dread when you get to get there, and then it's distracting. For me it is, it means I don't have a 3 turn off by the time you get close to airports. And I don't have to worry about mountains anymore and things like that. I turned off the pop on that, but I didn't apparently. Let's see, I didn't even see this airport coming up here. Should I have it? I have good visibility, so I can kind of see what he's on, it seems like. That's what happened. Every day was capitalized twice. Rain. Hits. The hits was mean. Struggling to stay alive. Stay alive, stay alive. Stay alive. Please, I'm not. Didn't stop him to see anyway. So, yeah, like I explained, this gives me the ability to do some sophisticated flight sim on Linux, which I appreciate greatly. They made a Linux version of this software. And it is having its bugs and its quirks and stuff like that. Generally, it works pretty well, though. Except when you're trying to record it with OBS, then it has a few other glitches I'm learning about. So it's like 2 o'clock over there, and 2:30 by now probably. And I went in for tomorrow's Sydney. I'm almost getting my whole circuit. But they will be in the circuit, I should see. Yeah, right. So anyway, yeah, I finished my whole circuit, and I was going all the way around the circumference of the runway I took off on. Probably, I know it's one of they tend to take you off on when you just take off on the runway. I think it's the left one. Or the right one in this case, might be kind of in the sea. See? Ha ha ha. Hey. It rained more in the bay. Right out of the bay. Woohoo. Let's see what we got here. We're flying over the airport now. Where is it? Spotted her. I would have been able to fly all the way to that. Say 5 miles away. I was ready to plan down there, but I was like, but I can land on the same runway, took off and beat the circuit. Around the pool of Australia. We'll fly over the bay for a while. look to the right and see a man. I'm sent to, let's see, which way to send to? Left to send to. Just remember back here for a minute. There's going to be crossing the line right here. So we're going to be right out. And let's see what we're going to be doing. We had to send to 1,000 feet. Surface and slurring, it's being harder to talk, seems like.
Some water might help with that a bit, but yeah.
It's 3 o'clock in the local time over here. Right. Yeah, it's about. And we're. Seeing it there, so anyway, so we need to change our altitude. Down to 1,000. Slow descent to there. We're going to feed a spin it. 500, that is.
1,000.
That is maybe much better. It's a landing. Hey, see, I think it looks like it's going good with the wreck I had. I thought I was having a perfect landing, but then I started bouncing. But I figured what I did wrong, basically. Had a habit of slamming the nose gear down on the ground. Right. Because you flare a bit, you know, so flared a bit. I felt my rear wheels hit the ground, and I slammed the nose gear down, and it caused me to start bouncing when I did that. But I was also coming in too fast, but that's another issue altogether. And now I can also. In the range thing there. Getting closer in. 1,000 feet over the sea. Fuel situation is good. There we have getting down to yellow 10 grams. I need to change it again, but I'm gonna have to. And it's 12 gallons an hour though, so with only 23 minutes left to go, we can on this tank, the left tank by itself, so I'll have to change it. But it's a GPS system that they tend to have on these planes. Where you drive a plane, go to this bay here, meet up with it. Okay, I gotta go. her handbag, and looks like we have about 20 minutes left to fly in for arrival. Coming right here today. Now, usually I haven't had any rain when I flew into this to Sydney before. I flew around Sydney and it was kind of been pretty clear, but I guess it is the best time sometimes. See, the reason you don't fly around just over 1,000 feet over the ground you did because I had a problem I did back there. Now, I wouldn't have much time to recover. Probably hit the water. So, we want to do that, the way you can fly as high as possible, most of the time. And maybe bring another launch in. Flying strangely enough to good place to pump fuel, you think? And it's the prime thing, something done or something. Maybe we just switch the tank first. I guess we switch tanks, there's a time where the engine didn't get fuel, so we shoot a little extra fuel in there. Keep shooting a lot of fuel in there, though, it's going to flood the tank, flood the engine type thing or something like that. So it's to help make these transition tanks smoother without any interruptions to fuel supply. On the other hand, it can cause issues. Yeah, I thought maybe I could fly in easier than the ocean side, easier than flying up from the mountain side, spending time for my mountains on the side. And we don't have to worry about ground, just have to worry about hitting the water, that's what we have to worry about it here. It's all level at least. We might fly 1,000 feet and stay well over it. Minutes. I'll be a little bit more than 50 minutes because we're going to have time to turn, go on the bay and turn, and then the runway, line up the runway and all that kind of stuff. Gonna trim it down a little bit and back in. Make it fine. And 12 miles out, we're in this 2.5 miles. And it's the same, it's at the coast. And that's exciting to look at. Still in the bay here. Sydney's located. The time approaches. Have a good baby. Celebrate it. Be cool. And I will break it down. Come on. Yeah. Been an interesting trip around in all of Australia. Saw things like you really could see a lot of things. And even virtually, it was interesting. See different terrains, different type of textures, different cities, unique abilities, and things like that. Three and a half percent power. So you have 36 knots ground speed. And I guess it was a engine 23 knots. Airspeed. And then 25 knots airspeed. 24 knots airspeed, and 37 knots ground speed. Making a good time. Just have to slow down a little bit more when we get ready to slow down. That didn't happen the way it should. We're only about 11 minutes when we come in to Sydney International, Kingston International. That'd be good. Good trip. But it's probably the last. Less concept. Yeah, a lot closer. So you're in 7.5 miles, that helps you. No, about 5 miles out. And I can start prepping for my landing at that point when I get there. And I'll have to actually come in from the day, but I kind of have to turn around that much to get there. Also, I decide when I'm going to take off the autopilot. Start head flying for the landing. it's almost got 15 gallons of tape. I'm switching because I'm too afraid of goofing it up again. I just have to make sure that no problem is clicked off the running before I leave, but sometimes the lighting on it's hard to tell. You know, so I was just for a click, and I thought about what I did here. But I didn't click it last time. Become pretty cool head on the right tip. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It really says not exactly how long it's gonna be, but closer it gets, more accurate it gets, I'm sure. A fun trip around Australia, that's for sure. I mean, everybody fly around Australia once and fly somewhere just for the fun of it. You never see anything really happen there, please. Life, really. Losing on something, you poop up because you'd have a cut engine plug and cut off. Suddenly your engine, your plane starts heading down the spiral. And so we're in the rings of Sydney International. This little land airplane, the cool airplane, I like it because I always had the keyboard to put in flight plan. So I have to do twist knob, butt, click, 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 all that kind of stuff. But also it has co-pilot seat and two passengers, and we had third one back there, I can't tell. Luggage and cargo and stuff, I guess. It's got two seats for passengers. Today, so we have about four people. So I understand some Cirrus SR-22s have five seats available for five passengers. Yeah, it's about time for me to start taking something off of flying, and make a turn pretty soon, so I better take it off, I guess. Get stabilized before I get there. 4 minutes, 5 minutes till we get there. Bring that puppy. So, we'll It's up high, flight director. GPS and Horizon at the same time. Heard up. Started the speed limit and turned it out. I made it. First flaps, getting rid of flaps. There's a bear. No rain right now. Yeah, this runway's over there, actually. Should be that soon, though. They say cut away the water, I remember. Let's see. Yeah, it's runway for sure. Yeah, I think I took off on that one left or left or right, depending on right when you're on that side, but it's left on this side. So I can land there if possible. Okay. Faster speed, make sure we get too close to the red line until it's time. Grabbed him in a spit. Celebrate the tap, tap, tap. Made it in Sydney today. Hello, Vince. In Sydney again, Vince. Yay. So there you go. I'm in Sydney. Circumference of whole continent, blah, 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 and my mind is going. It's been a long trip of seeing. I think of Antarctica in my way. I can't think of anything else. Australia. So I circumference the whole map of Australia. Australia left 11 days, 12 days ago. Well, actually, more than that, but 12 days virtual time. And it's like saying the last video. This is the only day that I haven't actually done a daily trip. First, all the way from to Brisbane, I did daily trips. Then I had to take a break for critical things here, moving into new spot for a while, that kind of thing. Next, we'll be moving back according to what we've heard. Yay! So we'll have a repaired ceiling. Prayer roof won't leak. We hope, pray. Anyway, thanks for coming along this trip for me. You see here then, you're more powerful than I am. So, glad I did make Sydney, and I'm glad I did. And despite our little almost mishap in the middle of the mountains there, that was a little bit scary. I couldn't bear what was going on at first. Wow, what's happening? Why did my engine suddenly stop turning? So, simple mistake, left fuel pump on. Too bad. So, at any rate, we made it. Yay! So that's what we have going on here. Now I'm back in Denver, back in my old habitats and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah. Should shut the plane down and we'll do that after this. So, at any rate, thanks for being with me, thanks for watching, thanks for the trip, coming on this last leg of the trip, as long as it was, and we'll see you next time. I make something else, probably an update on my PDA and stuff like that, but yeah, exciting, I made it, good feeling. Keep it up to the excitement, everybody. And remember, your lens force be with you anyway. Bye. Oh, I almost forgot. Two or three things. One, I had missed a couple of cities on my list, and I wanted to make sure they had on the video at least somewhere. So I'm plugging them in here. One is, let me see, it's Prosper Pine, Whitsunday, something airport. I forget what the last part is, I can't remember wrong writing, so. Anyway, the Prince, Proper Pine, we need that one in, and the second one is Norseman. City on the southern coast when I went from Usea to Perth. I stopped there for some gas. I forgot about that one. So I wanted to show those two cities got in. Now, the interesting thing about both of those cities, Usea and Norseman, is that Usea had an interesting configuration of spider, asterisk, whatever you want to call it. Had like a runway, had a main runway going like this. It had another, it went into one of the runways. It had three taxiways, but they were all just like this, you know. You can look it up online and see it. But the strange thing about the Norseman was that it's apparently on a dry lake bed. It's not on the bed, but it's on an island that used to be part of an island for the water. The water used to be there, but it apparently the water disappeared or went away or whatever, so it's just a dry lake bed, currently, at least.
So those two cities I want to make sure you got. The other thing I wanted to warn you about is that I'm getting ready to show some bonus footage. You saw me land inside the plane. You didn't see me land outside the plane. I'm gonna have to show that footage right now.